Adam Ant was an icon of the 80s, his records sold in their millions, his face gazed down from 1,000 bedroom walls. His videos are fondly remembered by a generation. When Adam was sectioned under the Mental Health Act after throwing a car alternator through a pub window, it seemed to mark the end of an extraordinary journey. From Prince Charming to public ridicule, from Top of the Pops to rock bottom.
It's the ultimate taboo, really. There's only one thing worse than going to the workhouse. That's going to the madhouse. They're at the bottom, mate. You're a freak show.
This is the story of that journey, about the struggle with an illness that came close to destroying him, but without which there would have been no Adam Ant in the first place.
It's fear, and I live with it every day, because depression doesn't go away. You can help it and you have to live with it, but you walk with fear.
The fear began before Adam was famous, before he was even Adam. Back when he was plain Stuart Goddard, born late 54 in a working class part of North London.
My first memory of Stuart was of hearing this noise coming down the corridor, screaming, kicking, shouting, bangs and thumps. The headmistress and another teacher with this screaming, kicking child appeared. They dropped him on the floor and said, "Now, dear, you can have him because you're so good with the difficult ones."
Stuart's mum was a seamstress who did a spot of cleaning for Paul McCartney. His dad was a hard-drinking chauffeur. The couple separated when Stuart was 7.
I've just recently been thinking about all of that. Everybody would like a happy family. I think it's important to have mum and dad and everything there. But it's out of your control personally. You just, I suppose it just toughens you up.
He put a brick through the window of the chapel next to the school. It was, you know, sort of spikes and trouble and anger and fury. And I wanted to calm him down, and we had lots of cuddles. I noticed how wonderfully good he was at art. And one day, he had a big sheet of grey sugar paper, which we used in school, and he drew the outline in charcoal, I think it was, of a goose. And then he was days cutting out little feather-shaped pieces of tissue paper. And when it was all done, we put it up on the wall, and every time the door was opened, the feathers fluttered. And it was really remarkable.
She was the first person to say, "But what Stuart's done, it's a really nice painting." And it was like, you know, that total, like, hooligan, this kind of total hooligan. And then someone was like, you know, and I just thought, ooh. And it was the first time someone actually said, you know, you can do something good.
Stuart went on to pass his exams and even became a prefect. And at 18, his artistic flair would take him to art school. He'd go there to study graphic design. He'd end up redesigning himself.
We had a band together at the time, Bazooka Joe, which was basically a kind of pub rock band. And Adam played bass. He actually dressed quite eccentrically, but not in a punk way. He'd wear sort of big designery type glasses. It's actually slightly nerdy, actually, a kind of sort of slightly super nerd.
In November 1975, Bazooka Joe played St Martin's College, supported by a band playing their first ever gig.
The Sex Pistols turned up, and as I remember, they didn't actually have any of their own equipment, so they asked if they could borrow ours. I found the music at the time pretty inept. I think Adam saw it as being sort of exciting and new, and that's probably why he went on to fame and fortune, and I sped on into obscurity.
1975 was the turning point in Stuart's life, the year he stopped being Stuart. He'd married a fellow student, Carol Ann, but with the marriage failing and exams approaching, he fell into a deep depression.
Pressure I just couldn't handle it at all. And I think it was just very confusing, and I became very depressed, became very ill. And I think with that situation you're talking about, you're trying to describe what it's like to go to hell. And it's not a good thing or a nice thing to talk about, but that is what it's like.
At 21, Stuart was diagnosed with bipolar affective disorder, or manic depression. Often genetic and generally triggered by stress, doctors say it affects up to 1 in 100 people. It can be treated. It can also be devastating.
Manic depression involves swings of mood. So a person can be at one time manic, disinhibited, reckless, delusions of grandeur, thinking they are omnipotent, thinking they are the most important person in the world, very aggressive, and then they can swing to feelings of depression where they go to despair, worthlessness, hopelessness, helplessness, and suicidal thinking.
I think I took some pills at some point. I was very, very, very desperate. I think it was a cry for help, really. I remember going to the really ancient mental hospital way up in North London. And it was just very disjointed, very surreal. I remember being taken down a long passage and they put me in this room. I remember my name being chalked up on a board and it had my name, Goddard, and it had treatment listed and it was gonna like shock treatment. And I just looked at me and they were sort of, I wasn't restrained, but sort of laying there. And then this huge, huge cockroach just sort of crawled up and just walked across my stomach. And I just said, that's it, I'm getting out of it. Because it was real, it was like, boom.
Stuart emerged from intensive psychiatric treatment feeling like a new man. His marriage was dead and so was his old identity. This was the birth of Adam.
When Adam came out, he dropped out of college, didn't want to be in our band anymore. He wanted to do his own thing and became very influenced by punk and actually did become Adam. Plastic surgery is
fantastic. It's almost like being given a second chance. All I wanted to do was get a group together and get on with it.
I definitely think punk gave a lot of people a chance to do things they always felt they were capable of, but didn't quite know how they'd do it under their own name. I think punk gave you an opportunity to wear a mask, change your name, change who you were, but actually find out exactly who you were.
Adam called his new band The Ants and threw himself into punk, the looks and the lifestyle.
When I first met him, he lived in a single room, which was all painted black. Floor, ceiling, carpet, the lot. There was a single mattress, and on the wall there were nails placed with strings. There was a toothbrush on one string, I think a pair of scissors and a comb. You can go on a stage where there's nothing but a chair, and the stage seems filled. Your every moment would be watching to see what would he do next, because it was very unexpected.
I used to go to a lot of the very early Ant gigs and they were absolutely amazing. There was sexuality, violence. It had an air of danger about it.
They used to spit at me and I'd sort of go off and get a fire extinguisher and like let it off at them and throw it at them. Hit them with a mic stand, throw anything I could find at them. I think it brought the best out of me. It's one of the basic things of recovery from any kind of mental illness is to try and fill it with something you do like to enjoy.
Adam was using music as medication, but friends became aware of the mood swings that would recur throughout his personal and professional life.
In those earlier days, he would go quite introverted, he'd spend a bit of time on his own, and then he'd seem to pop out the other side. Usually with a creative burst of a new song or a new concept or a new idea or a rebirth of image. But there'd definitely be an introverted phase in order to get in there. I'll fill your bath with
the finest champagne. I'll lick your skin dry. The Ants had cult status, but Adam wanted mainstream success, and that might mean a change of image.
Oh, gosh. Adam the Ants had all the sort of credibility and all, everything was wonderful. We had the audience that people dreamt of, but no money. It was a real strain to give everybody kind of, you know, a tiny wage.
So Adam decided to reinvent himself again. This time, he had some expert advice.
Listen, fashion is the last repository of the marvellous. The designer may be the last person who holds the wand of Cinderella's fairy godmother. So if you think of it in those terms, I was the guy that could turn Adam into a male Cinderella.
And he said, well, what do you want to do? You know, do you want to do underground records, or do you want to be on everybody's cornflakes packet? And I said, yeah, of course, I want to be as successful as possible. I want to be everywhere, and I want to live in a fishbowl. And he said, well, you're going the wrong way about it.
And I started to lay it out, what I think you should do. Think wild tribal drums. Think of yourself as a pirate. Think stories about Geronimo.
But the career's advice came at a price. Malcolm wanted the Ants to form a new group called Bow Wow Wow, and Adam wasn't invited.
He just basically organised a mutiny, really. He said the right things to them, and they went for it. And, you know, they were mates.
It wasn't really exactly like that, but I suppose it sounds good. It certainly fits with my image.
The end of the 70s found Adam with no band, no money, and seemingly no future. But this time, there was no depression. He just became more determined, more focused, and more driven. Within a year, he'd be the biggest pop star in Britain. He'd lost his band. He'd come close to losing his mind. But in 1980, Adam Ant was back. He had a new sound, a new look, and some new ants.
I had two drummers in there, two drum kits. Big, strong guys playing the crap out of these drum kits.
I listened back to some of those recordings and they strike me as quite bonkers. They are mad and they're fresh. They seem fresh even now.
Adam had a new writing partner, legendary punk guitarist Marco Peroni. For the next 20 years, they'd share the ups and downs, their fortunes entwined, for better and for worse.
I've never been married, but, you know, probably why I've never got married, really. So that's sort of, you know, got enough to deal with him.
Adam sort of ran everything. It was like his vision of the way the band should be.
I mean, God bless him, I remember when I first joined the band, he took one look at me and thought, I need to get this guy a haircut. I need to sort him out.
I remember he was always going, 3 years, I've been working at this 3 years, I've got fuck all to show for it, blah, 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 blah. You know, that's, he thought it was his right to be number one in the charts.
But right now, no show seems to be complete without a band called Adam and the Ants. Live on the show tonight, Dog Eat Dog.
We went on Top of the Pops for like 3 minutes. Dog Eat Dog, that was it. Next day, boom, 200,000 people bought the record. That 3.5 minutes took 3.5 years to prepare for, but you better believe it, once that camera went, mate, I knew that was my opportunity. I knew we were the best band in the world. I knew we looked great, sounded great. I just knew it. I can just see the joy, you know.
Oh, it was a devastating look. The moment Adam Ant appeared on TV with that white stripe, it was unquestionably going to change the look of music.
It was exciting, fluorescent, colourful, and not drab, shoe-gazing, introverted. I remember we were in the dressing room afterwards and we were just going, yes, yes, we've arrived.
Dog Eat Dog was the first in a string of 15 hit singles and countless front covers. It seemed as if Adam's troubles were finally over.
He sent me three of his records, all signed. This is Adam and the Ants. He was so thrilled, and he knew I would be, and he wanted me to know and to see and see what he'd done and where he'd got to.
All of a sudden, it's like 12-year-old kids and stuff are showing up and their mums and you know, and it, the fan base just changed completely. And that's kind of where I got a bit disillusioned with it, you know.
In early 81, the Ants played the Children's Royal Variety Show. For Adam, it spelt mass acceptance, but for his old punk audience, it was the ultimate betrayal.
Yeah, this is where it all happened. I got a lot of stick for doing it, really, but we did it after the show. We met Princess Margaret.
Here are the Ants, and of course their leader, Adam.
It's exciting. It's something you tell your grandchildren, and I was just very honoured by it, and people just couldn't understand it. They couldn't take it at all.
The night was memorable for another reason. It was bass player Kevin Mooney's last appearance as an Ant. Kevin handed his notice in live on stage.
You know, it's nice to, like, do the Royal Variety Show with, you know, the crankies and all that. But I was saying, no, we shouldn't be doing this kind of stuff. So I go out on stage anyway, and it's a bad atmosphere. And then either I break my bass or, like, someone sabotaged it. So I said, fuck it, that's it. I just threw the guitar down and just started not miming anymore and just, like, doing a stupid dance, you know, and that was it.
I knew he was going to do something. He threw a wobbler and we threw him out. The Royal Variety performance was the first time we sort of hit the national papers. With that, I mean, that was big, big news, and after that, that was pretty much a turning point.
Adam was the most written about celebrity of 1981, after Princess Di. He seemed to have a pact with the press. He gave them stories, they printed them.
You know, the NME and the Melody Maker, and no music paper ever, ever sold any records for Adam and the Ants, or me. I made my hits through The Sun, The Daily Mirror and The Star, and News of the World.
Adam was one of the first people who instinctively understood that that was the world to come, that pop and celebrityhood was going to be everything. It was going to be the world. You know, fame was everything.
Hello?
That summer, Adam was everywhere, in the papers, in the charts, on TV.
Oh, hello, how are you?
His drive, his energy was relentless, and I think for him, essential. I don't think there was any time for him to sit back and go, I don't feel great.
I've been rushing around, coming out the studio, or getting up at 8, going and having an interview at, like, 9 o'clock with the lawyers or something, and then having to go to a guy who's making my trail.
The way I ironically kept depression away was by working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and I was able to just... I didn't have time to get depressed. I just was, like, just completely...
By the end of the evening, I just make lists of things I've got to do. But one thing...
He dreamt about it, he thought about it, he'd then talk intensely about it, he'd worry about it, he'd plan it, he'd replan it.
I mean, there were times I've had to say, look, I'm knackered, I'm staying in bed today. And he just sort of laughed and said, OK, we'll meet up tomorrow then. I said, yes, we'll meet up tomorrow.
Why not? Friends thought Adam was keeping depression at bay by keeping himself busy. But this was manic depression, and the energy was part of the illness.
In the lower stages of the illness, what we call hypomania, a little sort of submania, you can be dominant, you can be funny and attractive. You can storm along being active, energetic, creative, ideas, needing less sleep, taking more drugs, using more women, really the star of the show, without anyone noticing.
Adam didn't take drugs, and if he had a weakness for beautiful women, well, he was a rock star. It was the perfect profession to hide the illness.
It's difficult to know, when you're in the middle of that bubble, how normal it is to be that mad. when everything's chaos around you.
The madness of an individual in the pop world often, you know, can be taken as just being a great bit of showbiz flamboyance. And there's no doubt that the best pop stars do demonstrate, you know, symptoms of something that, if they were obscure, you know, would probably get them locked away.
I mean, a lot of it was just kind of lead singerism, really. And there are far worse, there were far worse people than Adam, you know. Far worse.
Adam was restless, always changing, looking for new sounds, new ideas, new clothes.
These two waistcoats come from the film Charge of the Light Brigade, featuring David Hemmings as Captain Nolan, and was an inspiration for Adam for his role as the dandy highwayman in Stand and Deliver. The jacket went on, and I remember him looking in the mirror, doing some move, and he said, "This is it."
Adam would have to sort of like say, "We would like to do a video," and they said, "Okay. All right, well, you can. What about sort of you lot in a white room, and maybe we'll get some blinds in it or something?" And he said, "No, like a big video, like a film." "What you mean? Like, you're going to act out a film in a white room with blinds?" He said, no, we're not going to be in a white room with blinds, and we're not going to be playing guitars. We're going to be acting in these mini epics. After they got the idea, you could see the next thing, which was, how much is this going to cost? And he sort of said, "Well, it's going to cost $40,000. They just looked sick, thought he was insane. "I'm the dandy highwayman who you're too scared to mention. I spend my cash on looking flash and grabbing your attention. The devil take your stereo and your record collection. The way you look, you'll qualify for next year's old expansion. Style is deliverable. Money or your life." This was done in one day. This. Stand and Deliver. One day. Yeah, one day. We were pissing ourselves laughing. It's like hysterical, you can imagine it. There was like 50 extras in a fucking castle somewhere. Everything had to be done, the stunt. I jumped about 8 foot, landed on the table. I cut my head doing it though. "We're the dandy highwaymen, so tired of excuses.
Of digging in philosophies where only showbiz loses." It was Hollywood, and it was a very expensive video. Cast of thousands, and me having to do my kind of third-rate acting. Lots of hand-waving and melodrama.
They were all given a storyboard that I'd drawn out, so they weren't just standing about not knowing what they were doing. Things were a lot of passion and a great deal of hard work. People getting fucking cold, you know, uncomfortable, but went to number one. That's what matters, you know. Went to number one and fucking stayed there as well.
Stand and Deliver was one of the best love songs of the 80s. Adam was at the peak of his success and Britain was in the grips of Ant mania.
I interviewed Adam possibly absolutely at the moment of his pure pop, when it was T-Rex mania, it was Beatlemania, and I interviewed him in a hotel room that was literally surrounded by girls, 13-year-old girls, pounding on the door trying to get in. And I remember talking to him, and even then he was very troubled. At that time, you're not thinking about it during the interview, except you're thinking, "Oh, this will be a good quote. Oh, this will be interesting. He's troubled. What's he troubled about? He's number one. He's got all these girls banging on the door. He's what he wanted to be, a star."
He was very quiet, and I said, "Oh, just literally, I said, how are you feeling?" I said, "Oh, I'm okay, but I don't feel 100%. I said, "Do you ever suffer from, you know, depressions?" He went, "Yeah, I've suffered through, and I don't wish to go back there. It's not very nice." So I think he was very scared about these demons in the background.
But it was his writing partner, Marco, who bore the brunt of Adam's mood swings.
I realised now it was happening even when I was working, you know, all the time, and I didn't really have time to acknowledge it. And I think he could see what was happening and, in a way, just didn't really know how to react. You know, in my mind, it was like, well, what else does he want? You know, what's he miserable about? What's he depressed about? You know, it's that the classic, it's like a classic thing that people who don't know about depression say when they hear someone's depressed, and you say, well, what are they depressed about? And then you realise they're not depressed about anything. They're just depressed.
But Adam's relationship to his illness was a complicated one. While it would come close to killing him, it was also part of what made him tick as an artist.
There does seem to be a greatly increased pattern of mad depressive illness amongst the artistically successful people, whether it be painters, musicians, writers. I mean, Van Gogh is the obvious, most colourful image. You've got the poet Lord Byron, you've got Virginia Woolf. Because you have these heightened mood states, that probably gives you an advantage in creating new things. It also gives you a feeling basis in that you can actually express emotions which other people only partly feel, and you can bring them out for those who can't feel that far. So you can bring the message back from the far country and say, hey, this is what it's like to be seriously happy or seriously sad. This is the joy of living. And so you get Beethoven's, you know, Ninth Symphony.
But to his fans, Adam had it made, and he was about to give them a Ninth Symphony of his own. It's late 1981. Having been a pirate and a highwayman, Adam's searching for a new look. Again, he drew inspiration from the past.
We both had this amazing mutual admiration for the dandies of that time, who were very handsome, but they also could handle themselves if necessary.
Next, a video to showcase the new image. He needed something bigger and better than anything he had done before, with a special guest star.
Stand by then, good music.
Adam invited Diana Dawes. He wrote her a letter. He was a great fan of Diana Dawes, and he invited her to be in the video. I taught her the dance, and she was incredibly gracious about learning it.
4, 5, 6, 7.
Diana was wicked, she didn't, you know, did it her way, didn't care what everybody else was doing.
I'm gonna muck his hair up.
So where was I? Was I like there, wasn't I?
MTV hadn't actually quite happened, it was about to happen, so they were very slightly pre-MTV. And even though those videos now look very primitive and very sort of sweet and cute, at the time, you know, it was a big transforming moment.
Steph really invented the dance, not me.
Nobody actually knows, but those moves, the Prince Charming moves, actually mean something. Every move is a different meaning. Pride. Courage, humour, flair, which for me symbolised Adam completely.
To this day, people still ask me about the videos, and you know, I work with other groups, and you know, I could be there working away at the desk, and I'll turn around, and they're all doing this behind me, you know.
He was clearly exploiting the fact that from then on, what was going to be as important as the music, if not more, was how you looked.
Still, there was no let-up in the schedule. Having got to the top, Adam was working harder than ever to stay there.
No matter where he goes, the 1, 2 and 3 goes, we're always together.
I wanted my record in the top 5. And, you know, I had the choice between doing Morecambe and Wise or Cannon and Ball, and I did Cannon and Ball because the ratings were higher. Now, maybe people will think that's wrong, but it took the record from 3 to 1, and I had to get around madness.
But the frantic pace was taking its toll on the band. By early 82, the Ants were on their last legs.
Band members were kind of complaining that it was all a bit him and a bit like we're all being told what to do. And yeah, there came a point where people were disgruntled and a bit fed up with the whole thing. But a lot of that came from fatigue.
Instead of taking a break, I was kind of working into the next project halfway through one, and then going solo, and I kind of didn't really want to go solo, and you know, everybody got just exhausted and just had enough, you know, and I was I'd just keep going, because I thought if I stop, everything would just fall away.
It was almost like he'd got everything he wanted and then was panicking about losing it, even as it was happening, which to an extent might have contributed to him losing it, because he was so worried about losing it, he kind of lost it.
The Ants had split, although Adam still had Marco, and for the moment they still had hits. But the papers he'd targeted earlier in his career were just beginning to target him and his squeaky clean image.
If you're a rock and roll star or an actor going out saying, love me, I'm the one, don't buy their records, buy my records because mine's the best record, I'm beautiful, you want to sleep with me. And then when they buy your record, make you very, very rich and successful and famous, you know, so right now, fuck off, leave me alone because I don't fancy it today. So you can't do that.
In terms of rock and roll culture, he was a little too clean. He never drank, he never took drugs, he never smoked.
If you're prone to mental illness or are worried about it, one of the things you don't want to do is get out of your head all the time. You hang on to normality. The way he made up for not drinking or taking drugs or anything like that was enjoying the company of women, and I think he quite happily did that with abandon.
But Adam's attitude to drink went back beyond his first depression to his childhood as Stuart and to his relationship with his father.
You know, my dad was an alcoholic. He had very bad problems. He had a very hard life. I suppose, what is it, beer is the saviour of the working classes, and I think I could swim in what he drank, really.
Probably that's why Stuart doesn't drink. I think that's probably a reaction. Well, I don't really like to say this, but when he was famous, his father appeared on the scene, having been gone for years. And that didn't make Stuart very happy either.
In the mid-80s, the papers finally got their story.
I was in rehearsals and I got told, you know, your dad's been arrested for indecent behaviour with a minor, and I was just completely, you know, because I have very strong personal feelings about any kind of child abuse. And my family were hurting really bad. I just took care of them and let it run its course, really. He went to jail, served his time, worked in the library, they let him out.
Did it impact?
It killed him, though. He died about a year after. Yeah, dropped dead.
By that time, the hits had dried up. The teenage girls had moved on, and after a brief, dazzling period of success, it looked like Adam would have to reinvent himself yet again.
You know, he had 15 hits, number ones in America. Someone as sensitive as Adam, it's the worst thing when you realise your moment's over and you're so young, you know, and you realise how hard it was to achieve it in the first place. You know how hard it's going to be to achieve it again. You know, having that second act, that's going to be really hard.
At 32, Adam Ant relocated. After exhausting everyone around him, he had finally exhausted himself.
I didn't really know who me was for a while because you're just so hammered. You know, you're just sort of like punch drunk, you know. And so I went over there, bought a little house in Los Feliz and just got down to basics, starting just doing my own shopping, you know, just having a life.
It's either a new beginning or the beginning of the end.
Adam enrolled in acting school and was soon picking up parts in TV shows and B-movies. Things seemed to be going okay.
Take it! Make me proud!
But depression was once again stalking him. It would take him back to hospital and to the very brink of suicide.
First time I had an inkling that maybe something not quite right was the day that Kurt Cobain died, and I called him up about something, and he said, have you heard about Kurt Cobain? And I said, yes, stupid twat. Like, you know, blows his own head off. Idiot. And he said, no, it takes a lot of guts to do something like that. And I sort of thought, I didn't say anything. I said, oh, maybe. And I put the phone on and I thought, what does that mean? That's a really odd thing to say.
It will give me the greatest pleasure to kill you.
But Adam was already starring in a real-life drama, more scary than any he'd acted in.
I was living with my girlfriend at the time, and then this Hispanic girl turned up one day. And she just stood there very seriously and just said, you know, I am the one you love. We are married. This person you're with is, you know, a whore and, you know, we're devoted. And, you know, there's nothing you can say about it.
Adam Ant was one of the first celebrities to be stalked. He'd always asked his fans to love him, but Ruth Marie Torres had a rare psychological disorder. She thought he loved her in return.
The person who's suffering from erotomania actually believes that some other famous person is in love with them. They're convinced of this, they know it's true. That little hand gesture when watching them on TV, looking at the newspapers and seeing something he said, that means it's true.
I went out one day and I came back and something wasn't quite right, and I went into the bedroom and I saw the door was open and it just didn't seem right. I thought, oh, maybe it's the dogs, I don't know. But I went in the kitchen and there was this cake on the kitchen table, and it just said, had a note saying, get the whore out of the house.
They'll bombard them with letters, with phone calls, with flowers. They'll try and get them alone. They'll do everything possible. And in a sense, they can behave like jealous lovers. And there's nothing more dangerous than a jealous lover.
After a 3-year terror campaign, Ruth Marie Torres was jailed. California would shortly introduce new anti-stalking laws, but for Adam, it was too late.
If you weren't depressed before you get a stalker, you will be when they're through. Because it drove me bonkers. It drove me nuts.
In August 1994, Adam was admitted to the Cedars-Sinai Hospital in Hollywood, suffering from major depression and suicidal tendencies.
I was in a relationship with a very lovely actress, Heather, and I mean, she didn't know what had hit her, you know, I mean, and literally, you know, would come to this Cedars-Sinai Hospital every day and, you know, hold my hand. I couldn't speak some of the time, you know, I couldn't speak. It's like depression, mental illness, depression certainly is like having a fist smashed right in your skull and someone implanting a Hieronymus Bosch style, your worst memories, your worst feelings, your worst terrors in your brain, and then pulling the skull out, but it's there. You don't want to sort of eat, drink, make love, talk, and someone sticks with you, and it's very, very, very difficult.
After 6 weeks, Adam was discharged, but his relationship with Heather Graham ended shortly afterwards. He returned to England, but he would bring the demons with him.
I'll tell you how much I miss.
By the mid-90s, Adam was living back in England. He married again, and though it didn't last, he had a daughter, Lily, who he doted on. But friends noticed a difference in his personality.
He was home from America, and he invited my son and me to dinner at the Ivy. And we had a wonderful meal, but he did seem unsettled and tense, and I didn't know why. I knew he had been ill, but all I could think was afterwards, I wonder what's the matter.
We used to go for these famous walks in St. James, which would end up at Fortnum Mason's for afternoon tea. Normally we'd have a kind of a fantastic conversation, went and see each other, and we'd sort of look at the kind of various shops and saying, this is where the dandies used to live. This time there was a lot of looking into space. I felt helpless. I'm trying to think of the word. A lost soul.
Did I tell you I was? When Adam was again treated for depression, the paper said he couldn't cope without fame. No, but incredibly, it seemed he was still paying the price for it.
I started getting these very strange letters. Then I was just trying to get my daughter to sleep. Ring, 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 ring. Open the door, and there she is in it, and she just stepped into the doorway and wouldn't go away, just would not go away. She thought I'd planted a chip in her brain and I was sending messages to her through the radio to come and see me and be with me.
Adam had to go to court to get rid of this new stalker. By then, he had the chance to appeal to all his old fans by topping the bill on an 80s nostalgia tour. He'd turned down similar proposals in the past. This time, he said yes.
It must be awful when you've had ideas in the first place that were slightly kind of uncompromising and about integrity and about being at the cutting edge of something, to realise that your future can only be in exploiting your back catalogue, and that you're going to have to dress up in that silly costume with that silly makeup in a way that was OK when you're in your mid-20s but isn't so OK when you're in your mid-40s. But you kind of know that people will take the piss out of you.
Now, Adam, we have a chandelier behind you.
No, just stick it up your jacket. I'm not doing it. Stick it up your bum.
How tempting.
Yeah.
Adam never made it on tour, although there would be a kind of comeback, one that neither he nor his old friend Marco would have wanted.
When he had his depression, I found out what depression was, because his doctors told me. That's okay, I understand that. What they failed to say is there's another bit to it. There's the manic bit.
Adam had kept the manic bit under control in his pop heyday, but now, 20 years on, he was caught in a deadly upward spiral. He was ascending into full-blown mania.
Once you swing up into the state of mania, life becomes incredibly chaotic. There isn't the same focus, and once things become chaotic and behaviour becomes chaotic, more bizarre, more reckless, more dangerous, and the person becomes a danger to themselves or other people, that's when things become critical and hospitalisation is needed.
So we called his doctor and said, look, we know we're not family members. We're not asking you for privileged information. We're just telling you what's happening. And the guy said, well, what do you think should be done? And I said, well, how do I know? You know, what are you asking me for? I'm a guitar player. You're a psychiatrist, you know. Do I come and ask you about fucking guitar playing?
On a cold Saturday morning in January 2002, Adam's friends gathered in North London to try to convince him to get help.
He was still manic, but he was very happy, you know. He'd bought us presents and it was great to see you and how are you and blah, blah, blah and all this. And then he said, right, I must go now. And we didn't get a chance to say, no, hang on, Adam, we have to talk to you. No, I've got to go, I'll see you later.
Just remember it being bitterly cold, being scared out of my wits and terrified that something bad was going to happen. It's like a dreamlike state, you know, in a dream you're kind of supposedly watching what's happening. And so it's a bit like that.
And the next day, Sylvie calls me and said, he's in the police station. Well, I said, oh, great, well, what's he done? So he's gone into a pub with a gun and tried to hold it up. To which point there is just like a silence, because there is no words to find to express your kind of... You know, the only thing I could say was, oh, fuck.
On January the 12th, Adam Ant came to this pub in Kentish Town. When he walked in, locals began taking the mickey out of him, whistling the theme tune to the film The Good, the Bad and the Ugly. Adam Ant left but returned a few hours later armed with a starting pistol and part of a car engine, a heavy alternator, which he said he had found in the street.
2 days after the incident at the pub, Adam Ant was detained for his own protection under the 1983 Mental Health Act. He was back inside the psychiatric ward of a British hospital and he was back on the front pages.
It was just turning into like the most fantastic disaster. You know, it's like usually sort of celebrities try and keep this stuff out of the paper, and they have teams of people that you have to pay lots of money to try and keep this stuff out of the paper. What does he do? Gets to the hospital and phones the Sun up himself.
This time, Adam wasn't reading his reviews. He was hitting an all-time low.
I think people tend to look at One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest and except there's no Jack Nicholson and there's no sexy middle-aged nurse, none of that. There's nobody doing party pieces. It's not a sort of New York off-Broadway play. It's, you know, people wanting to be dead, people wanting to jump out the window, people, you know. You don't taste the food, you're not interested in sex, you're not interested in talking. You talk too much, the smell of piss, shit. The smell of death, really. Not good.
80s pop star Adam Ant has been charged with assault and possession of a firearm.
It's like 80s has been Adam Ant, and we put him on the front page. The whole thing is like funny, it's tragic, it's exasperating, it's entertaining, it's everything all at the same time, it's depressing.
It's funny and peculiar watching celebrities go through their real life and have these kind of terrible mishaps and these terrible moments that mostly would be private, but because he once upon a time was a pop star, we somehow, you know, bring him up to date, but only to enjoy his downfall, as if somehow we get something out of that.
Two decades ago, he was the dandy highwayman of pop. This is Adam Ant now.
What a different looking man, indeed.
Okay, bit of sport now.
Ridicule's nothing to be scared of. It's one of his lyrics.
I was really upset by all the horrid publicity. I mean, poor boy, he was ill.
Morning, sir. Morning,
sir. I just thought, all you got to do is walk down this street, go up them stairs and go in and take your medicine. I know that the media are going to be there and, in a way, I just tried to work out ways to get through the door without them recognising me.
He did call me out one day. He said, I've grown a beard. And I said, have you? He said, yes. I'm trying to be like Ernest Hemingway. Then we had a sort of discussion about the court case, and I said, well, look, you know, I can't, you're not going to go to jail. You know, you were nuts. He said, yeah, I know you're right, but I'm still scared about it. And I said, yeah, well, don't blame you, really. And he said, I'd give you a call next week. And that was sort of last time I spoke to him, really.
All bar one of the charges against Adam were eventually dropped and a 12-month community rehabilitation order imposed. The judge decided Adam was the victim of an illness that had plagued him all his life and which had finally pushed him over the edge.
It's my greatest regret in my life that I put my friends and my loved ones through it. I feel I'll never be rid of the shame and it's shown me humility.
It's uncertain when or if Adam will perform again. Since recording these interviews, he's once more had to spend time in hospital. His battle continues against the illness and against the shame.
There's people attempting to kill the stigma and the disgusting prejudice against anybody with mental illness. There is help available, but you have to know where it is and you have to be able to ask for it. And you mustn't feel ashamed of asking for it either. You just have to put the work in. You know, is that a chestnut one day at a time? It's like 1 hour at a time with this, mate. And when you're really sick, it's 1 second at a time.